of 1983. A tremendous memory of the conference that we enjoyed last January. But we cannot look back into that sepulcher and behold the wrinkled grave clothes or the folded napkin. We're not just here to talk about the civil cocoons of yesterday. Though faith does not live in the past, faith is nourished by the past. So I'm not here to say where the grave is, but I'm here to say where is that living Lord? Where is the Lord God of 1983? And he's right here in 1984. And I feel a date of destiny in this meeting as I listen to Brother Rex Johnson preach tonight. Suddenly it hit me. Whenever the general word of God goes out with power, there must be a specific word for me. And nothing is dynamic until it becomes specific. You can leave here and say the congregation was blessed by a great message. But what was specific to you? What did the Holy Ghost say to you? You know, I felt a kaleidoscope of emotions from the Holy Ghost as he was preaching, and I could almost hear that rattling of brains, some of them my own, as we said, "Now, Lord, that's not for me. And he doesn't understand my circumstance." And you know, the ultimate pride is to try to fashion everybody else to be like we are. And we're not here to try to make you be like Brother Mandan, Brother Johnson, Brother Urson, Brother Penny, but we want to conform to the image of the Son of God. I want a specific word from the Lord, and I've got one. I've already got one. A specific word. And that man had a message for us tonight as a foundation. So often, it's so easy to blame circumstances, things, people, even superintendents from Arkansas, or presbyters from Texas, amen, or general superintendents, or neighboring pastors, or anything. You know, didn't get the break. But my friend, that man told us. Whenever, you know, that fifth chapter of Isaiah, five times he said, "Woe is Israel, woe is this." But in the sixth chapter, when he got that specific word, he said, "Woe is me." He said, "I got it. Woe is me." And that's when God used him. And P.F. Penny will not be used of God any further until I get a specific word and I can say, "Woe is me." And then I'm ready to change. Somebody said, "I never change." If you quit changing, you quit growing. We welcome you to Louisiana and to this tremendous meeting. If there's anything that we can do as a district or any of our pastors or preachers can do, well, here in Louisiana reside some of the finest pastors, evangelists, local ministers and churches in all the world. And we welcome you to the Bayou Country in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, where we too want to crown him king. And it's just a delightful experience to be again in this church. And I want to thank Brothers G.A. and Anthony Mandan for the tremendous work that's gone in to the preparation for such a meeting as this. And this great church, I want to thank them publicly for their hard work. And now it's my distinguished pleasure to bring to this pulpit tonight one of the finest men of God that I've ever known, our beloved General Superintendent. And he is our leader, and we respect him, admire him, and I believe that God has given him something for us tonight. Sometimes we come to a service like this and we shout, and sometimes we come and we soak. So I don't know whether Brother Urson's message will strike the chord of shout or the chord of soak, but whatever the Lord has given our great General Superintendent, I want to hear the voice of God tonight. I want to hear it. Brother Urson, our hearts are open to receive your ministry. We love and appreciate you. God bless you. Come preach. Thank you, Brother Kenny, Brother Megan, Brother Kilgore, for something that's been very special to us. The meeting last year was tremendous. Those of you who were here, you went away changed people. And this year is going to be even greater. Because there's a presence of the Holy Ghost here that's tremendous. Let me express appreciation to the Mangans for several things. First of all, I remember the little frame church on Repeat. It was going nowhere until these precious people came along and felt the burden, not only of the church, but of the city. And they built a larger church there. And they built this building. And they're looking forward to building another building. Brother Rex Johnson, I appreciate his message. I love every hair in his head, Teddy. You know, the Mangans went to work with a fervent faith in God that he could bring to pass something that had never happened in this city. And it has happened. I didn't know what Brother Johnson was going to preach. I had no idea. Didn't talk to him about it. We had no discussion about it. But I know that we're in the will of God. And I'm going to do my best to preach to you tonight. I make no apologies for what I'm going to say. I hope we can really open our hearts to the white, bright light of the revelation of the Holy Ghost and let him really get to us. We're right at the verge of revival. I'm talking about a revival that's sweeping in power. We're having revival in our churches. We're seeing it. We're having revival in the Philippines. We're having revival in Ethiopia. We're having revival behind the Iron Curtain. There's a little Chinese man tonight in a school in Canton that has baptized over 100 people by just teaching them English from the Book of Acts. Behind an iron curtain, Almighty God is meeting the hungry hearts of people who are seeking God. So beautiful to know that. But we want a sweeping revival. Something that just doesn't stop at the doorstep of a church but moves out into community. Actually, the rivers of life flow through bars and through partying, deviations from morals and everything else, tears up little houses that have been built in tradition and restores apostolic power. We need that kind of revival. And I believe we can have it. And I'd like to say further, I think you know how to have it. But we've let too many things encumber the feeling and the thinking of our own personal ideas. We've been coated with a callousness that's so hard to penetrate. We've built our own little sense around our own little ideas, and we refuse to move out of them. We'll never have a revival till we flow together. I'm talking about speaking power. Men locally are going to catch a vision and they're going to have revival. Then they're just, they're having it. But when everybody catches a vision and they begin to speak the same things as Paul talked about, you're going to see sweeping revival. We're talking about revival at headquarters. We're talking about it in the corridors. We're talking about it when we sit down and talk to each other. We're talking about revival. We are going to have a real Holy Ghost apostolic revival by the help of Almighty God. And I want to thank you, Brother and Sister Mangum, Brother and Sister Anthony Mangum, for using your facility, but more than that, the great potential that is in this church to make a base for what we're feeling. And we're thankful to God that you brought us here and you have it here this year. And I'm looking out at an audience. There's potential here tonight, my God in heaven, if we can ever set it free. If we can ever set the potential free that's in this place tonight, we can sweep the nation. You believe that? Is that just mental affirmation or is that something that comes out of your soul? We can have it. Let's go to the word of the Lord. From the 20th chapter of the book of Matthew, let me read to you what is a very, very informative portion of the scripture. Then came to him the mother of Zebedee's children. This is chapter 20, verse 20. With her sons worshiping him and desiring a certain thing of him. He said unto her, What wilt thou, she saith unto him, grant that these my two sons may sit, the one on thy right hand and the other on the left in thy kingdom? But Jesus answered and said, You know not what you ask. Are ye able to drink of the cup that I shall drink of? We need to address that question. And to be baptized with the baptism that I'm baptized with. Another question that needs addressing. They say unto him, We are able. Almost a premature answer. He saith unto them, You shall drink indeed of my cup. Be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with, but to sit on my right hand and on my left is not mine to give, but it shall be given to them for whom it is prepared of my Father. When the ten heard it, they were moved with indignation against the two brethren. But Jesus called them unto him and said, You know that the princes of the Gentiles exercise dominion over them, and they that are great exercise authority upon them. But it shall not be so among you. But whosoever shall be great among you, let him be your minister. And whosoever will be chief among you, let him be your servant. Even as the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister and to give his life a ransom for many. Praise God. Let's worship the Lord. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Blessed be thy name. Blessed be thy name. Praise God. You may be seated. The Lord bless you. Looking at these scriptures tonight, we are hearing the voice of a doting mother for the future adulation of her son, because to the credit of Sister Zebedee, to the credit of her, she knew something great was going to take place. She had been observing the year of miracles, and even though she may not have understood what was going to take place in the totality of the purposes of God, she knew something great was going to take place. And she was like any mother, I want my boys to be right there at either side of you when you come into your kingdom. The Lord said it wasn't his to give. I want you to know tonight that there's no free seats in heaven. And I want you to know also that there's no free, easy way to achieve the spiritual ultimate. There's a price to pay to get any place in the kingdom of God. Rex Johnson said it well when he said, the game of politics doesn't place you where God wants you to be. It is the great persevering desire within a man's heart for the things of God that makes him reach the spiritual ultimate. I'm going to take the blame with all of the rest of us who have developed the kind of a climate that we have created in this moment of the human suffering and need. And I'm talking about our movement. We've created a climate that actually has placed a situation within our thinking that is wrong thinking. We have a strange fascination for success through attainment to popularity. This is the kind of thinking that has been passed on to this generation. We want achievement without sacrifice. We want seats of honor without Holy Ghost power. We want high titles sought after lacking commitment to conquer evil. The frenzy for possessions and no regard for a lost world. Adulation and fame at the sacrifice of effort. Name glorification. Let my name be big. We want a big name for human reward. We want ascension without service. It's in the climate of Pentecostal adaptation that somehow we've got to break through all that crap. It is debilitating. It hinders. It breaks down the real issue. It doesn't cause us to contact God. And we're coated with it. We're at the point of moving into great, powerful revival, but we can't break that shell because we're comfortable with it. Let me say something else to you in connection with this. Unfortunately, we have adopted role models. We picked out who we wanted to be like. You made reference to that. We use words instead of compassionate concern. We sarcastically denounce the pioneers of yesterday. We're swayed by the enunciations of men who, in their explosion of quick success, satirically degrade the foundational consecration of yesterday. And I want you to know we didn't get here by ourselves. We have adopted these role models who dip with slurring language of disrespect. Not only that, their concentration is on colorful personality instead of on Gethsemane convulsion. We permit Christian conduct to be clothed in priestly prattling without an ounce of eternal conviction. We're hurting for real men, stable men, burden preachers, preachers with sincere conviction, and not hypocritical fakery. Ecclesiastics who not only preach prayer, but practice intercession. This turns it into Zebedee's desire. Where will my boy sit? Oh, friend, we've got to address these questions that Jesus asked of those men. Can you drink of the cup that I drink of? And he was talking about real discipleship. The turning of human friendship against standing for truth. John 6 declared something, and I want you to hear what John 6 declared. He had come through this hour of power and strength when miracles had been performed, but now his face was turned toward the cross. Remember always that before the greatness of revival can ever come to individuals or to total bodies, somebody has to die. Somebody has to pay a price. Somebody has to make a sacrifice. You don't roll into revival just on the basis of desire without doing something about it. Somebody has to give something somewhere in order that it might come to pass. And he was standing before the people, and he made a statement, you must eat my flesh, and you must drink my blood. And when he said that, many, many walked away from the scene. Hundreds that had been following him because of miraculous outpourings upon people, not realizing that they were standing next to the God man who could do anything. They began to walk away when the real issue began to develop. The real issue is, can you eat my flesh and drink my blood? What in the world is eating my flesh and drinking my blood mean? It means simply, just simply, can you suffer the way I suffer? Can you drink of my life, the kind of life that I live and walk in this world in that fashion? I don't know if you realize this or not, but just a few years ago, we got a letter from behind the Iron Curtain, Estonia. There was a young lady by the name of Suzanne there, who for years had been a servant and a missionary. She was a young lady that God had used mightily under the heel of communist oppression. We had received letters for years from this girl. I had actually typed letters for my dad as he would write to Suzanne. Her parents were baptized by him. She became a mighty vessel for God. The Russian government said, stop your proselyting. Suzanne said she wouldn't stop. Later on, from the city of New York, went a man by the name of John Sikora from the church in New York, a Russian by birth, who had walked across this country and painted on the tops of rocks and mountains, Jesus saved. Acts 2:38, he had walked all across this country by foot, and everywhere he could paint some kind of statement, he painted about the Lord and about his power to save. He went to Russia, married Suzanne. The two of them became mighty vessels in the hand of God. They touched the whole nation of Ethiopia, or rather of Estonia, and they were told, stop your proselyting. And we got the message one day. They had taken Suzanne and cut out the part of her brain with which she thinks. And John Sikora wrote, my beautiful Suzanne is a vegetable. They have destroyed her thinking process. Over in that suppressed country was a woman that would not back away from the Russian machine. She took her stand, and she went at it like her Lord would go at it. You wonder why there are thousands and thousands and perhaps 2 million Pentecostals in Russia today? Somebody died that somebody might live. And we've got the strange idea we can have revival just by talking about it. No, no, no. We need to talk about it, but we need to put it into action. And we need to have that kind of something in our system that says we're going to have it at any cost. You heard a man at our last convention. You heard a man at our last convention. You looked him in the face. He smiled at you and talked to you in the Yugoslavian language. His nephew interpreted what he said to you. Do you know what that man went through to bring Pentecost to Yugoslavia? He went to a prison camp. He went through beating. He was beaten so bad, I wanted him to talk about it. These people who go through these things hardly ever talk about it. You can hardly get them to talk about it. But when I sat across the table from him, Brother Barnes, in his language, with that beatific smile on his face, he said to us, that day, the happiest day in my life, was when I suffered for the name of the Lord. thought I was hearing things. I turned to Sam and I said, Sam, am I hearing things or is he telling me something that's so? And I asked him to repeat it, and he repeated the same words. I was happy in that jail when I suffered for the name of the Lord, because he said, I knew God was going to do something special. He said, they told me one day I have to go to the doctor because my body was so full of sores from the bugs that had eaten into my flesh and down to my bone that I was dying. He said, I stood in water up to my knees and could not lie down for weeks and weeks. If I'd lied down, I'd have died. I stood on my feet and I praised God. I slept against the wall with my shoulders up against the wall. But he said, when I came out with all these sores on my body, he said, they said to me, you got to go to the doctor. And I looked at them and said, my God's going to heal me. They said, you're crazy. Your God can't heal you. This is the way these atheists or communists talk. Your God can't heal you. He said, my God will heal me. He was down by the riverside one day. They had just beaten him, kicked him, till his whole stomach was ruptured and his insides were hanging out. The prisoners didn't want him to be near them because of the stench that came from his body. And he stayed away from people because he was filled with putrefaction. And he said, he went by that river. He stood by that river. He said, oh God, if you let me walk through these waters and heal me like you did Naaman of old, it'll be a real testimony to all these people. And the man went down in those waters, came up out of that water, healed. He doesn't live yesterday. He lives in our generation. He's been baptized with the baptism that the Lord was baptized with. Oh, friend, we need to have that cup and drink that cup. And we need to understand that drinking the cup separates us from the rest of this world. Our pioneer preachers, I want you to know, were cast out some thousands to a few, Brother Kilgore. When they took their stand for this one God message, they were cast out of huge congregations. Some couldn't pay the price. I picked up my dad, an old witness of God, the other day, Brother Kenny, and I was reading, L.C. Hall will be preaching in Chicago, 1922. You know what happened to L.C. Hall? He went back to the crowd. I picked up that paper and read again. William Booth Gibbon will be preaching in this great revival we're going to have in Chicago. You know what happened to William Booth Gibbon? He couldn't pay the price, and he went back to those crowds. But there were others that paid that price, and they went to the few people, and they stood fast on the solid doctrine of what they were cast out from. And we have what we have today because of them. They drank that cup. Oh, friend, let me say, do you know lonely prayer nights, lonely vigils where nobody stands with you, and you're all by yourself, and you're feeling the weight of the oppression, of all the disappointment that you run into when you preach the gospel? Look, this preaching business is no fairy tale life. The preaching business is no colorful place of honor. If you've been in it after a while, you don't look for adulation. You look for reality. You don't look for popularity. You look for the hand of God. You don't look for somebody to tell you how good you preach. You're wanting to know, why doesn't God come down upon us with his mighty power? It's because we don't want to drink the cup. We want it without price. We want honor without really getting down to the base facts of it. And we followed verses that told us we could have it with promotion. We followed
can have it by getting it out there in the bright light. You tell the voices, you said, you can put it on television and that'll bring it. No, that won't bring it. Radio won't bring it. Television won't bring it. But let somebody rise up in some little nook and cranny with a ministry like John the Baptist. Let somebody pray, fast, call on God, hold fast to God. He'll break the windows of heaven open. You gotta drink the cup. Hallelujah. You know what that drinking the cup is? Not my will. Not my will. Please forgive me if I offend you. There's a stubbornness in some of us that is so nasty that we will not let the Spirit of God puncture us. We know what's true. You can hear the truth, you hear it from lips to understand it. We got a great mentality for the truth. We have actually picked up the truth of the name of God by virtue of our study of it. But there's more to that name of the Lord than just a mental digestion and absorption of fact and of scripture. There's something got to be in here that believes it's in your gut. It's got to be in your bloodstream. It's got to be in your nerve system. It's got to be in your mind. It's got to be all through your being. And if it isn't in your being, you haven't really got it. We got to drink the cup.
I'm looking at a fine young man, Jim Larson, my successor at Calvary. Precious man. I thought when he took the church, you know, he's a young man. Somebody says, can a young man function in that state? Let me tell you something about youth and age.
Anybody can touch the throne and have the glory of God and have the power of God demonstrated upon him. Age doesn't mean anything to God. He can take an 80-year-old barefoot Moses on the opposite side of the desert and bring him down to Egypt and lead the people of Israel out of Egypt. Or he can take a Josiah at 8 years of age and give him a persevering desire to restore revival in Israel, and he can come up and restore revival in Israel. The cup. It demands too much of me. That's why you won't have it. That's why you won't see the victory at the Calvary. We need a Gethsemane. Oh my God, we need a Gethsemane. I'll never forget this. These things just live in your mind like a livid memory. I'll never forget the day that I first ran into a pastoral problem when a whole bunch of folks said, well, leaving the church. You know what was bruised? My ego. Oh, God, a minute. Why, my Lord? If people leave the church, what will people think of leave the church? What will people think of me? You know, that's glass and glass. It really doesn't mean anything. Friend, that isn't what should be bruised. What should be bruised is your concern for their spiritual life. What will they do away from the truth? What will they do away from the house of God? This is what we should be concerned about. But we're egotistical. Man, there's so much ego in Pentecost that it's pitiful. It needs a complete breaking down. There's paranoia in Pentecost. We're so suspicious of everything until we're looking out of the corner of our eye at somebody else. And God wants us to get rid of it. He wants us to get it out of our system. He wants us to get a good, wholesome, down-to-earth healing and rest. There's no places of honor in the kingdom of God for people who put self above God. The simple basics of God: seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. So simple that we fall and stumble over it. So simple. And we too busy. You know what you came from. As a great people, you know where you came from. I know where you came from. I know where this man came from. I watched, and I tell you what I saw. I saw a basic life in this man's life for the things of God. Did he ever tell you where he came from? He came from a poor home. He told you the story of his poverty. He could make you weep. He is respected, admired, loved because of what he represents. Wow. He got hold of the champion star. He put his hand in the hand of Jesus and began to do the things that were expected of him. And the poverty that he one time had is not his now. And I'm not talking about him being a wealthy man. I'm talking about there's so many rewards in the kingdom of God that we stagger at rewards. When we think we got it made, we sit down and say, I've arrived. You haven't arrived. You know what we need? We need what David said he needed. I'll never be satisfied. I'll never be satisfied until I awaken in his likeness. But we've built this kind of a system to be great means that you drive a big car, you live in a beautiful home, you have great big funds of money to sit at your expensive dinner. That doesn't mean a thing. There's a dying world. You have no idea. A man asked me a question the other day. How many could you get to go with me behind the Iron Curtain? And I was begging. I said, I really don't know. Because if you do go behind me, you may not come back. But I think of that little lady in the flat, in the third-story apartment that we visited, and the underground says, man, you had to see this. You had to see this. We had to go all kinds of things. All four of us took care. We went in different directions to meet at one point. And when we met, there was a man with a hat over his head. He didn't even ask any questions. We would follow him. We followed him through alleys, through different portions of blocks in Russia, and up the steps in an apartment where the underground church leaders, eight of them, were waiting to see us. When we walked through those doors, oh, friend, they grabbed us, and they wept and wept and wept and said, thank you. We didn't understand their weeping. We didn't understand their happiness expressing weeping. You know why they were so moved, Brother Lumpkin? They didn't know that anybody this side of the world cared for them. They thought they were alone fighting that beastly government. And the other day when we were talking about it, there were people who were saying, oh, if you could only know what one little visit would do to encourage the saints of God behind the Iron Curtain, you'd run across the seas to get there, to see them. And then when they asked us to have a word of prayer, that word of prayer went on for an hour and a half. You never heard such intercession. Why do you pray like this? Our brethren are in prison. They're dying. They're beaten. They're blind. They're deaf. They are being destroyed. And we are wanting God to deliver them. That's in this generation. I'm not talking about yesterday. I'm talking about now in our generation. They're drinking the cup while we're sitting on read for me, Brother Kilgore? Please. I want you to read from Matthew 12 and begin, I believe, is at the 38th verse. When certain of the scribes and of the Pharisees answered, saying,
listen,
Master, we would see a sign from thee.
Show us a sign.
But he answered and said unto them, an evil and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign.
Oh, yeah.
And there shall no sign be given to it but the sign of the prophet Jonas.
All right.
For as Jonas was 3 days and 3 nights in the whale's belly,
yeah,
so shall the Son of Man be there 3 days and 3 nights in the
whale's belly. One sign, the sign of the risen Christ and the dying Christ. Just one sign to get. If there's not another miracle that ever happened to this world, only the sign of the crucified, risen Christ is sufficient for the salvation of the world. What I'm concerned about is that because of our selfishness, because of our coded feelings of comfort, we're missing apostolic demonstration because we won't drink the cup. But listen to what he says about this generation.
The men of Nineveh shall rise in judgment with this generation.
He picked up the generation hundreds of years in antiquity. The men of Nineveh are going to rise.
And shall condemn it.
Condemn what generation? The generation Jesus was talking to.
Not my will. Mike Tumanello, can I tell about your phone call? Mike Tumanello called me one day. I appreciate it so much. He said, Brother Urshan, I've been selfish. I have been so disrespectful. I'm sorry. I'm never going to be that way again. I'm going to be a different man. I'm going to serve God. You can count on me. If you ask me to do anything, I'll do it. Oh, Mike, you don't know what that meant to me. To hear that big old frame of a body saying, I'll subject myself. Oh, if we could understand that. Who do I bow to? I'll tell you who you bow to. You bow to Almighty God. But in his great purposes, he has set those in the church to guide us in directions where we reach out into the heavenlies and touch the throne and get hold of that power that moves men. You say, what is the left for us? If I look over at Russia, God can raise up people over there today to stand at the judgment bar and say, we drunk the cup, you didn't. You say, how do I drink the cup? By denouncing your own will and subjecting yourself to the will of God. And people got the strange idea that the will of God is always beautiful and perfect and happiness and harmony. Not so. You think Gethsemane was a picnic? You think Gethsemane was a picnic? You think that looking at that cross was a picnic for the man, the God-man? Someone says, was he really man? Sure, he was really man. Was he the God-man? Yes, he was God. He was truly God and truly man. And he showed us that in that submission to divine authority, there's power. And we know that, but we don't want to drink the cup. Can you be baptized with the baptism that I'm baptized with, Oh, you heard it. They said, we're able. They answered prematurely. My Lord, have mercy. They answered quick. And there were those that were dying, crucified upside down, beheaded. One man lived, but they boiled him almost alive. They drank the cup. They drank that cup, but they persevered. The generation died, but the truth didn't. What was that word in Hebrew, Brother Rex Johnson? Shabbak. What this generation does means so much to this generation. Means so much to others that are coming along. Look at. Turn around and look here. Bright eyes. Bright faces. Holy Ghost faces. Holy Ghost conduct out there. I know you love the truth. I know you love the truth. But we haven't drunk the cup. What about being baptized with his baptism? He knew there was coming that time when he would have to be the object of everybody's hate. Can you be baptized with the hate of people? They hate you because of the truth. They hated Jesus. They hated our early oneness pioneers. They hated them with a passion. That doesn't stop the truth. Oh, man, you know what I'm thinking about right now? Here we are with the truth in our hands. All we need to do is drink the cup. All we need to do is follow him in the walk that he followed. And let the hate fall off. Let the envy fall off. Let the rejection. Have you ever been rejected? Have you ever had somebody turn their back on you and just let you know, I have nothing to do with you? I'm going to say something at this point. I hope you understand what I'm saying. It's just in recent days that this movement has begun to understand it's not to a confined few of the white middle class. I'd have said that 10 years ago, there'd have been a lot of opposition. But we've got to learn it's to every creature. It's to every nation. It's to every culture. It's to every individual. It's to all mankind, whether you're rejected or not. Who of you would sit down by a woman by the wayside well who had the kind of reputation she had? He sat there, and those disciples got hungry, and they went to eat. When they came back, listen. When they came back, they said, you're hungry. He said, I have got meat to eat that you don't know anything about. There's a meat that you'll eat when you sacrifice and pass by the plaudits of men to enter into the sacred area of the dimension of sacrifice that you will enjoy greater than anything this world can offer you. You've been rejected by your brethren. Baptism of crucifixion. I'm going to say to you, I've never suffered like some have. I have not. Excuse me for saying, I envy them. Sister Thetis Tenney, I told your sister, Sister Rich, the other day, I'd go to jail for her. And I would. You say, why? Just to let this whole world know we stick together. This is not just some kind of another doctrine in another church. This is something where the body of Christ is at stake. Someone tells us that many are weak and many sleep, because they don't understand the body of Christ. What are you talking about when you say you understand the body of Christ? That means you suffer when the saints suffer. That means you'll hurt when somebody else is hurting. That means that when somebody gets in trouble, you don't close your little door and say, they got into it, let them get out of it. That isn't the way it should operate. This church should be moving in every direction. When somebody is injured and hurt, we should be reaching for them. When somebody needs our help, we should be giving them help. When somebody needs our means, we should be giving our means. We should be baptized with the baptism he was baptized with. We don't understand the principles of the body. The aching of the body for the hurt of somebody else will produce the most glorious expressions of love. Then, in just such simple words, the Gentiles exercise authority. We like the authority syndrome. Oh, give me some position. I'll show them how I'll operate. You're a big fool. Authority syndrome has seized us. Let's get to some place where we can sit in some little throne while we preen and everybody says, ha-ha, who cometh up the lane? Who cometh down the street? Ah, ha-ha. The Gentiles exercise authority, domination, but it shall not be so with you. If you're going to really drink my cup and be baptized with the baptism I'm baptized with, minister. 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 Just be a minister. Just a good old-fashioned God-called man of God. Plain and simple, but what a price when we have so much affluence dripping from every direction. Who will be the chief among you? The servant of everybody. You know what a servant is? A servant loves a master. That's why they're so willing to submit. I don't think she'd like for me to tell this, but I want to tell it. I have a very wonderful woman that lives in our home, Olga Hyde. I've watched Olga pray and fast, Sister Mangum, for days. I've watched her come into the house till she was staggering. And I'd have to say, my Lord, Olga, you've got to eat. She'd be staggering. And she would be weeping as she came in from her moments of prayer. When she works at headquarters, it doesn't make any difference what she does. She'll do anything you ask her to do. She'll do anything you ask her to do. She'll come in and serve you. I said there one day, I said, you keep the house of God so clean. You keep headquarters so clean. You're so willing to do anything. She said, I do it as unto the Lord. I do it as unto the Lord. Is there anything bigger than that? Tell me about it. Tell me if there's anything bigger than that. There's nothing bigger than that. I don't do it to get my name in the Alexandria Town Talk. I do it to get my name in the Lamb's Book of Life. Because it may be that you won't get it there. It does say in Matthew or in Revelation 3 and 5 that some names were blotted out. I don't want mine blotted out. I want my name in there. But the willingness to be a servant has to develop a kind of a determination of love for God. You don't care who spits on you. Lita Vaschenko laid on a table with 16 white-coated men standing around her. 2 were doctors, 14 were KGB. They were telling the doctors, put her away. Take her life. When the 14 KGB men left, the 2 doctors looked at her and said, we're going to help you. We're not going to do what they said. We believe in what you're doing. Could you be rolled into a surgical room with 14 KGB men standing there saying, kill him, kill him? Maybe we'll get the chance in America. It's possible we may get that chance. But we need at this conference and at in ensuing days to know who we are and be willing to go all the way. Let me just close briefly here. Praise God. Let's praise God. This starts with a call from God, and it becomes a magnificent obsession. It becomes the rule of your life. Popularity can come. Prosperity can come. It doesn't mean that much to you. The ideals are still there. I started out to walk with Jesus. That's the way I'm going to end the walk. It doesn't matter what comes between now and then. If he blesses me materially, I'm going to use it for his glory. If he gives me honor, I'm going to use it for his glory. I'm going to be like this God man who showed us how to get to the top by servitude. Not only that, but by loving mankind. You can't love people unless you have the divine agape, because normal human love is not sufficient. Normal human love responds to compliments and somebody loving in return. But he loved when nobody loved in return. The divine agape means that what they do to you, they can hate you, step on your feet, they can just absolutely make you almost a ground hamburger, and you can say, I love you. When he hung on that cross, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. He called their sins ignorance. If he had not, we'd all be dead. And I'm convinced we were ignorant. And I'm convinced we're ignorant tonight about the things we're doing, because we don't understand how far we can go with God. Oh, here's a young man here with a tremendous ability to preach. Here's a young man here with a tremendous ability to preach. Here's an elder of the church who was just like this young man years ago. Here's another token of what is so great in this movement tonight. Men that love God. Here's another man that loves the cause of God. I could go all across this platform. Here's another man with great and marvelous abilities to do the things that God has called him to do. We stand together here tonight. Where will we go with this church? What will we do with this church? Just leave a niche and a name? Or are we going to touch our generation? Our God can raise up a Queen of Sheba that had no direction for going, but she made an attempt to go somewhere. And he can raise up anybody and judge you because of the extent of what they did. He can take the athletes of this day who will actually fast from food, who will go through Spartan training hours upon hours, and turn to the church and say, you wouldn't do that for the gospel, but they did it to get a material prize and get a name for themselves, when we've got the thing that has the bridge between eternity. Oh, I want to cry. I want to weep. Our love is so cheap. It's just mouthings. We can mouth love to one another and then strike with our vicious tongues. It's so bad. He doesn't want us just to talk love. He wants us to pour it out. Somehow in the inside of us, there has to come the divine agape that just pours itself on a sin-sick world. Don't you think they won't feel it? They know when you love them, and they know when you don't love them. My wife wouldn't have to tell me one time that she loved me the rest of my days. She wouldn't have to say one time, I love you. She has proven it by every little act and deed and expression. I know that. Don't doubt it. I don't have any doubts about it. I know that. There's arms that reach to embrace. There's a smile of welcome. There's a sweetness of tone. There is a willingness to sacrifice. I know that. But here we are. The greatest love in the world is the love of God. It pours itself out. When somebody in the church gives you fits and trouble, don't kick them. Reach for them. You find out whether they're reprobate sooner enough. If they're reprobate, they'll be gone. You don't have to worry about them. They'll be taken care of. But if somebody's struggling to really reach the goal, reach for them. Don't be a Gentile authoritarian. You're a minister. You're a servant. And so you reach for people. We're in the people business. Hallelujah.
Hear my cry, for I have heard you. You have gathered my attention. I've seen your fasting. I've seen your desire. I have looked upon you, and you have come to the portal of the court of heaven. You have come to me with great desire, and I have seen that, and I appreciate that. My passion and love is flowing towards you, but I am in a great dilemma.
Praise God. Praise God. I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather have Jesus. have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than a houseless or land. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hand than to be a king of a vast domain and be held in sin's dread sway. This old world affords today.
He's sweeter
than the lily,
than the lily honey
of rarest bloom. He's sweeter than the honey from out of the cold. He's all that my hungering spirit needs.
Oh, just give me Jesus.
I'd rather
just give me Jesus.
Have Jesus
and let him lead.
And
take
let
over
him
Jesus. Take
lead.
Over Jesus.
Than to be a king of a vast domain and be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything,
just anything
this old world affords today than to be a king of a vast domain
and be
held in sin's dread
in
sway.
Oh, I'm telling
oh,
you
yes,
that.
I'd rather have Jesus. Let's puncture all that means nothing and come through. Than to be a king
of a vast
domain
and be held
in sin's dread sway.
Oh, look up to him and tell him I'd rather have you, Jesus.
This old world
today.
He's fairer than the lilies of rarest bloom. Oh yes, he's sweeter than the honey
from right out on the cone.
Oh yes,
that my hungering
spirit
needs.
So I'd rather have Jesus
and just let him lead. than to be. Those of you can get between your pews. After such a message, I think every one of us need to seek God. I know it's crowded, but if you can get between you, get out in the aisles, move those chairs, fold them up. Get out on our faces. Let's seek God here. Fold those chairs up. Lay out in that aisle. Seek God tonight. Thank you, Brother Urshan, for such a great message. Everybody on your face seeking God.
A king.
We better hear it.
We better hear it. We
better take heed.
We better hear it. We better hear it.
That's it, choir. Seek the Lord. That's it, choir. Seek the Lord.
It came from God.
Please like, comment, and subscribe.